Hey folks, welcome to the Cactus Atlas. I'm your host Glenn, and today we're going to be exploring the ghost towns of Southwest Utah. So the star of our show today really isn't Zion. I'm not actually planning on stopping and doing any hiking or anything like that. I plan on just driving through and sharing this really beautiful drive with you, and there may be a stop or a pull off along the way that I might want to check out if I can find a place to park. But the main destination is an old pioneer town where people were poking around in that area in the late 1850s and really heavily settling it in the 1860s. So, and there's some really well-preserved remains of that period of history in one of the most idyllic settings and most beautiful settings that I've ever seen. Imagine being one of the first pioneer settlers in the 1800s to encounter things like this. There were people who saw this for the first time, as well as the natives that lived in this area over the centuries. Just imagine what they would have thought. This is something else. The scales here are unreal. The main intent for taking you on that beautiful drive to start things off today is that the Zion will be the background for this ghost town that we're visiting today. One of the most beautiful places in Utah, I have to say. And I really wanted you to experience what was inside of the background you're going to be seeing in this video to understand the scales of that. I think it'll just enrich everything else. So, but on to the main attraction. I think this says it all. You could see part of the rising swell of Zion National Park in the background. And these appear to be happy cows, well-fed. Look at all this pasture they have to graze on. But you cows do know that you are not native to this area, right? And you guys disrupted many other people's lives out here with your hunger and ceaseless eating and voracious appetites. You who's currently pooping as I say this. Welcome to Grafton, Utah, or what's left of it. Behind me you see the town proper, I think probably what's considered the center of town, because you had a church that also doubled as a schoolhouse here. And there would have been many more buildings. There aren't too many that remain today. This would have been a little bit bigger of a town. Let's start touring this place, and I'll tell you the story of Grafton as we make our rounds and add a little bit as we go. And we'll just generally enjoy this beautiful heaven before us. The story of Grafton bases its roots when the Mormons settled this area in the 1840s, looking to escape persecution and build a very self-sufficient society led by Brigham Young. To support that self-sufficient vision, Brigham Young wanted to move settlers south to grow cotton, and this is the region that he targeted where the earliest settlers came here in the late 1850s, I believe, but probably by the early 1860s they were settling in the area trying to grow cotton, but not here at this location. They were actually located a few miles downstream. There was a flood, or a very long flood, that pretty much wiped out that other town, and then settlers moved to this location and then started to try to make a living out here. They would grow crops like alfalfa out here, and they would quickly learn to really make a living and to support the animals and livestock they were trying to raise. It wasn't going to work to grow cotton. They pretty much had to use the land to take care of all their other needs. According to the sign, around 1864, I think there were about 168 or so people living here in this town. I can tell all you Old West enthusiasts that these structures are very well preserved, and for the most part, they're very much intact. The only restorations that I've read about are the roofs, but they used period techniques, I think, to build things, so it's very authentic, and they talk a little bit about that. And then they redid some of the door frames and windows. Other than that, as you'll see, you could very much tell the logs that they carved still have the markings where they cut them by hand. So you know this is the real deal. Okay, so this first structure that we're gonna tour today is called the Sarah Hastings home, I think. I found a map online that shows a map of this town with existing buildings, and it marks out the existing buildings, and then it also shows non-existing buildings. This is listed as a non-existing building, making me wonder that if this has been restored and rebuilt since the map I found was published. It's probably what it is. And all we have to do is walk right by what I assume was some kind of a cellar or storage thing here out back, being that this is the back of the house. We'll peek out the front. There's a fence, so we can't really walk into the front, but you can go in these buildings. Everyone except one, you can actually go in. This is the Sarah Hastings home. I mean, it's devoid of any furniture or anything, and you can clearly see this is more modern lumber. The roof, definitely restored, but then come look at the walls, and you tell me. This is OG pioneer wood. And that door doesn't seem too young either. I have to believe this is representative of the earlier type of settlement, and it's very reminiscent of things we've seen in Arizona, pioneer home, like one room homes, where you could have like a family of 6 to 8 living in a place like this. You could have a bed for Ma and Pa, and you know, an oven. Sometimes they even said kids slept on the floor. That's true. I've read that. And you know that smell I always talk about, that musty old wood smell? This is it, and it's kind of piney too. It's got such a good smell. I'm gonna study some of this wood with you, and there's better examples of this, but you see all these like cross hatchings all over the wood, and what I surmise that is back in the day they probably cut this by hand in the 1800s, so if they wanted a flat surface, I imagine they had to chop it like that, and you'll see more of that a lot clearer a little later. But yeah, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful home, and scenery to boot. Look at that, there's a rabbit out there on that field. Isn't that heaven? I read that in the early days, each settler probably, or each family had about an acre of land to farm out here. And a lot of these fields were probably the land they worked. You would have seen people in period dress working these fields back in the day. Horses going by pulling carts, oxen plowing the field. All with that as your background as you worked and toiled. I wonder if it made the labor any easier. So this settlement was built due to the close proximity to the Virgin River. Somewhere off that ways, there's a trail I think I may have spied. See if we can seek it out. But the same Virgin River that cuts through the narrows at Zion, which I've done. So if you know about that, you know it's amazing. But these people made an existence because of that river. So they would try to dig irrigation ditches to irrigate their crops. But I heard that they had a really hard time here because the Virgin River here puts out a lot of mud and silt, so it oftentimes clogged their ditches, and they'd have to like unclog them on a much more frequent basis than the average settlement would. If you think about that though, you know, when you're making your own food and making your own way, that's calories burnt. The more work you have to do, the more food you have to produce. It's not like you could just go drop by the grocery store and pick up a frozen pizza or something, you know? So I think those things mattered a lot more than one might think. All I know is this home was the John and Ellen Wood home, built in 1877. And there's a barn out back and like a shed or something, also built in 1877. All of which have been slightly restored. Okay, well, let's go into this home, this pioneer home built in 1877. Wow. Yeah, you just push on the doors. If you didn't know, you probably wouldn't even try. This fireplace is pretty ornate. You can actually see soot from use in there still. Modern graffiti, unfortunately, pretty sparse, but still, it sucks. And being that back then there was no electric heating or whatever, it's not uncommon that they'd have multiple fireplaces in different rooms. And here you go. And I'm actually just remarking, this one had some significant work done here, more than some of the other ones that I've seen, but it's still awesome. Just having the walls still be here and the floors is plenty. I think we should be very thankful for that. Ooh, this room's like all exposed in brick. I wouldn't be surprised if this is more indicative of what it was like before major restoration. I guess they could salvage this. This is a little bit sketchier, I would say. And creepier too. It's hard not to have that feeling of wanting to look over your shoulder in places like this, especially when you're all on your own. I don't know why I like that. Oh, listen to that creak. Yeah, that definitely seems like a different material than what we saw outside. I think it's the same brick, but out there it's, you know, certainly painted over as you saw. You could actually do a contrast right there and see the difference. Now we get to do the creepiest part of the whole episode, is to go into a cellar with an earthen floor beneath here, somewhere beneath one of these rooms. In fact, you see the hole in the floor right there? That's the cellar. I have peeked my head in here already, so I know what to expect, but it doesn't make it any better. Like, I just don't like, you know, earthen cellars. It just sounds horrible. And I can't see good now in here. So being in the cellar, kicking up dust as I'm walking around, it raises that dank, earthy aroma. You know, over a century of boots have trod over this dust and toiled and probably stored, I'm assuming, jarred goods and things like that. We've seen, like, at Pipe Spring National Monument, we saw an example of a cellar. And here's a shelf, in fact, that you would think that they probably stored things like jarred goods and whatever they're growing and preserve. It'd probably be here on these shelves, next to these dank bricks and this spooky floor. All right, let's move on to the next place. All right, let's go get a closer look at these 1877 structures here. I even think they said some of the fencing and stuff is original. Anyway, it didn't really break down what is what. I mean, obviously the main barn is here in this beautiful afternoon light. And then let's peek our head into this barn right quick and see what we can see and smell. Ooh, I like the way the light is working off the beams right here. So this is an 1877 model barn. The roof looks completely rebuilt. And once again, these sides, the walls are probably what are original. Not even sure, that beam's probably not even original, but still that's good enough for me. And there's a bunch of surplus wood being stored here in the middle, so pretty neat, but not worth analyzing too hard. Here's probably some of the original beams. We'll kind of take a look up close to see if we can see any of those notches in them. These look like they might be too worn. Oh wow, those doors might be original. There's actually a wagon in there too, you see that? That's wild. Cool, so we don't actually have to go in. This is better actually, because there's really no room to go in anyway. What would you really do? But I bet you that's a period wagon from right around here. So when we talk about like these settlers, this was their transportation. And all the while, the sights of Zion beckon in the background as we plow the fields. I imagine by this time of the day, they're probably still working, using that daylight. But it's probably getting close to dinner eating time. I don't think this place is a huge secret, but at the same time, I'm like, man, I don't want to get the word out or help spread the word because, you know, I want it all to myself. But it's probably difficult to do because this has been a very popular place throughout time. They actually filmed Hollywood movies here, a lot of old Westerns, even back in the silent era. But the one that I read about that's probably the most well-known is Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, I think with Robert Redford and Paul Newman, wasn't it? All right, we're about to get into the town proper, and we're gonna start with the only building that you can't go in, but they do have steps so you can peek in one of the windows. This would be the old schoolhouse and church, originally constructed in 1886. The last class met here in 1919, it says, the school class. How cool. So like I was saying, on this side, they let you peek in the window, and we're going to, of course, but it's nothing much to look at. Very empty. There's some information about the church up here, and boy, not a good time of the day to try to do this, but really you just see like a finished floor. Probably the original floor is just finished. And then there's information. I think there's even a picture there. That's pretty cool. There would have been like a hotel or saloon next door, it looks like. That's no longer there. Or that may have been a movie set, because they did use this area as a movie set also. I'm sure for some of you, this is probably a familiar sight. But for those of you that this is not familiar, you're welcome. This is known as the Alonzo Russell House, and it was built circa 1862. And this one has also been partially restored. You could see gutters up there. But I'm gonna start in the basement of this one. There's a big group of people that just got here too. So I wanna see if we can beat them. Whoa, this is freaky, man. All right, this one is dark. And without my camera, I couldn't see very well. Whoa, this is cool in here too. And there are stairs that I think we could actually go up to get up there, so. All right, I'm gonna go into the Alonzo House, 1862. Now everybody's cleared out, so I'm gonna have it to myself. But before we go in, let's take another look at those tall mountains. This late afternoon plan worked out like a charm. I really should be filming outside right now. There was some local kid that came up on a bike and was talking to the other family and was warning them of some homeless guy that hangs out in here, and he says he doesn't like to come in here. I've been in here many times today. I haven't seen anybody, but doesn't mean that once it gets dark, someone's not sleeping in here. So being that haunt season is coming up, and Amy and I love haunted houses and haunts and fun and like Knott's Berry Farm kind of stuff, not Scary Farm, I should say. We never get to go. So this is my tribute to the haunt season, even though I don't think we're going to see any paranormal phenomenon here. You never know. The lighting in here is so cool with the light coming through the door and even the walls. The light pokes through at times. And I wonder if that's one of the chimneys here. I'm sure it is. And you can see the wood here is, the beams look newer, but some of these, maybe they repurposed some of this stuff. Because some of it looks new, but you could see newer wood on the other side. Wow, the lighting in here is spectacular. And I bet if I were grandma in a rocking chair, or grandpa in a rocking chair, I'd like this to be my little nook with my view of that through this dirty window, but grandma would have cleaned that, trust me. There would not have been filth like that on there. The floor here is especially flimsy. Look at that, see that? I don't want to contribute to problems, so I'll stop, but yeah, man, this place is no joke. There's one more 1800 structure to see. And we're out here on sunset, probably about a half an hour away. Perfect time. We still have to see the graveyard too, if we have time. All right, so I think the same guy, this is known here as the Alonzo House. And I think the guy's name was Alonzo H. Russell, and he built a home for his wife here in the 1870s. I wish I knew more about the people and their stories than I'm able to tell you on this episode. But that's the best I can do. And wow, look at this. I think this is a good specimen of what I was trying to communicate earlier. All of the wood in this house is just very primitively like cut. And I think to get this flat shape, once again, I don't know if they just chipped at it and chiseled it like this, but you see that everywhere. So these were, those marks were likely made by Alfonso or, you know, other people here in the village, people that actually lived here. It's signs of the past on these original walls. Now, these really have a good pattern going, very well preserved, it looks like. This room is very eerily lit. It's like orange. I guess the sun's setting out there is why. And there's the only other people that were here. They're leaving, so I'm alone again, as I've been most of this episode, exploring Utah. What is this curious contraption here built into the wall? That's very odd. It's like a chute that goes nowhere. Anybody know what that is? Let me know. I've never seen some weird thing in a pioneer home like that. Let's look out the side here. It's very nice views here. Someone needs to clean the windows. That's why they need a caretaker, I think. I read that they're looking for a caretaker to live on site. I saw it on some blog or something, so I don't know if that was outdated information. But, you know, when I think of things like that, how cool would that be? Let's have like a trailer or RV out here and clean the windows. And right now is the goldenest of golden hours. I would say I hit it, and I should get a medal or a cookie. A cookie would be good. Anybody have any cookies? There's only one thing left to do. We need to go see a cemetery. Here I stand at the location of Grafton Cemetery, right up the road, and right within view of that beautiful scene we've been seeing. And I hear a cow mooing. You hear that? Wow, this is an iconic Southwest moment, man. This is a beautiful cemetery too. You can almost see like where the waters run between the mounds where the bodies are buried here. You see a mixture of like stone and sandstone markers and wooden markers. And these here that are of particular interest, I think, very ornate. Don't think that when I talk about how nice it would be to live back in the Old West, how idyllic it would have seemed. It does, like in a book or a movie or a Cactus Atlas video. But believe me, I know how rough it was. You have people in here that died of scarlet fever, tuberculosis, killed by Indians. I mean, it was a rough time, you know. A lot of these graves are so well taken care of and ornate, like this one. I assume these are original. This one especially is such a beautiful headstone. 1878, but then you look at some other ones, same style, probably the same maker, and other ones are just destroyed. Like this one here, I wonder, probably the same craftsman that made all of these. They have another stone here, Mary Electa Gibson, 1872 to 1879, so she was young, and so on and so forth. But it's curious how some of these tombstones are worn and then that one is like perfect. I really enjoy finding wooden tombstones, especially if they're real, like from the time. And I don't know why they wouldn't be York. I mean, because there's just something so rare. And in the Southwest, you see some of this. Sometimes you just see the splintered remains of these. Oftentimes you can't read them. These are some of the easiest to read ones that I've ever seen. And I think I'm seeing like 1860 something died. These are the 1866 deaths. So all of these are probably the diphtheria deaths. I also think I read this fence here was a restoration for whoever this family is here. I think there's multiple graves in here. This would be Robert M. Berry and Miss Isabel Hales. And there's like three small tombstones there. I wonder if that's children from the time. In addition to the settlers from Grafton down there at the time, I think there's also a few Paiute Indians buried here. I didn't do enough research really to know what to look for, unfortunately. But I'm just here to soak in the aesthetics of another ghost town cemetery. All right, folks, you know I have to say goodbye now. Tip my hat. Hear the coyotes? And the cows? There are coyotes right out here. The coyotes are coming out to play. You have a lot of those out here near Zion. I don't see them, but they're out there among the crickets and the cows, about to sing their nightly melody. Good night.